Thank you, Father, again for this great day that you've given us, always an opportunity to come before you. We thank you for the mighty hand of blessing that you've stored upon us in this day. We thank you for our health and the strength, Lord, that you've given us. And we thank you, Father, for those that have been sick and been hurting in hospitals and so forth, Lord, that need a healing touch. We know, Lord, that you have touched and you have blessed and healed and lifted them up once again. And we thank you for it. But, Father, there are many others that are not here, God, that are sick and still hurting. We pray, God, that you will continue to put your hands upon them and restore them. And, Father, for those that are serving our country all over the world, we pray that your blessings of peace, your love, will be with them, Lord, and help them. And, Lord, that whatever comes their way, that you will help them through. But, Father, we ask you now to look down upon this service this morning. For our guest speaker that will be here this morning, God, we pray that you will bless his heart with the precious word that will be anointed from heaven, that will surely open our eyes and our ears to what you'd have us to know and understand about your precious word. Bless those that have come today seeking you, Lord. We pray, God, that you'll pour out your spirit this morning that will surely help us and encourage us as we walk through life's pathway. But, Father, we ask you now to bless the service in a special way. Reach that soul that may be among us this morning, Father, that hasn't understood that they need you in their life. That they may repent this morning, receive salvation and life in you. For we ask it all in Jesus' holy, always precious name. Amen.
This world gets to me, and I need to find some peace. takes my hand. Here I go.
Oh, here I go.
Yes. I go walking, walking with the Lord on my knees. I go talking, talking with the Lord on my knees. Yeah. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy.
awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water.
Shake hands, let folks know you're glad to see him in the house of the Lord today. Glad you're with us today. And hi, everybody, I'm Carlton Duck, pastor of Gethsemane Baptist Church in beautiful Lynchburg, Virginia. A privilege today to have you with us in worship. And today is a special day at Gethsemane. Just came off of a fantastic weekend of Easter, souls being saved, and the great performance of Worth of the Crown, and just a great day of blessings that God provided for us. But today is another great day. And with us today, speaking a little bit later on in the service, will be Brother Bob Lee. Bob has been such a blessing to me personally, to our community, and we're so thankful for him and his love for the Lord. I know he's going to bless you in song and message rather today. I don't believe he's singing, but if he wants to, he can do that too. But anyway, Bob's going to be sharing the ministry of Mount Pisgah Printing Ministry that's getting the word out, the Bible, to many countries where people can hear the word of God. And then you'll hear a fiery message from this great man of God. Stay tuned. Also, come worship with us at Gethsemane Baptist Church. We've got a lot of events that are coming. We've got a youth-led service on May the 3rd. And we want you to mark this date down on May the 17th here at Gethsemane Baptist Church. We'll have with us Tribute Quartet. That'll be at 10:30 on Sunday morning, 6 p.m. on Sunday night. It's going to be a great time. Just don't miss the opportunity to be in the house of the Lord and to worship our God, because He is worthy of our praise. Amen. We're going to go back into the music now and just praise God. Look forward. Good morning, brother. To a great time in God's house, and may you be exceedingly glad and greatly blessed of the Lord today. Stay tuned for more good singing and the preaching of God's word, and come worship with us at Gethsemane Baptist Church, 411 Blue Ridge Street, right here in the heart of Lynchburg, Virginia. God bless you today.
When I heard about his healing, oh, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again, and he caused the blind to see.
Because in him and through him we have victory today. Amen. You may be seated.
Okay, thank you so much. I always feel at home when I come here to Gethsemane. Amen. I think that's where it ought to be. And it's a great joy to be here. My wife and I enjoy the hospitality that we always receive and the kindness of your pastor. And we're grateful for him for the privilege. Thank you, preacher. And for the great privilege to be here this morning. Well, folks are still lost and still need the word. And will be till Jesus comes. And I know I was here last year. And I'm here this year. And if Jesus tarries, and preacher, I hope I'm here next year. And just trying to reach people. Just trying to reach people. I'm glad somebody reached me, amen? Amen? Somebody reached out to me, and I'm so very, very grateful. And, you know, today I was thinking about how long I've been saved. I've been saved 45 years. And I'm glad I'm saved. My greatest thing ever happened to me. And, you see, Jesus Christ came to pay a debt he did not owe because I owed a debt I could not pay. And there are a lot of others the same way. As a matter of fact, everybody's like that. And so we're here this morning representing Mount Pisgah Scripture Printing Ministry. And what do? We print Bibles. My wife and I, this is our third year with Mount Pisgah. We have printed over 15 million copies of God's Word. And we provide them to missionaries who do not have funds, the means of paying for the scriptures, but yet they need them. We print in 16 different languages. And let me give you what, this is the New Testament. We print the New Testament. This is our military New Testament. We also print John and Romans. And we print the whole Bible. And so we print in those three. We're trying to raise funds this year to provide, and this is awesome, 40,000 Bibles to the country of Sudan. Now, we have the door that's open. We have the missionary there. All he is waiting for are the Bibles. And so we are raising funds to print 20,000 copies of the English Bible and 20,000 copies of the Arabic Bible. And we hope by the end of the year, God helping us, that we'll be able to ship to him 40,000 copies of the Bible. Now, if you go to the map, you'll see right across the Gulf of Aqaba there, you have Yemen, and right across the Gulf is the country of the Sudan. Now, you know the condition of the Middle East and the different things that are taking place there. And there's not anything more valuable than placing within their hands a copy of the Word of God. Amen. Nothing any more valuable. This will change their life. Change my life. It will keep them from becoming an extremist that wants to kill me. Amen? Amen? And wants to kill you. Because God will work in their lives and work in their hearts. And so this is the main thing that we're working on this year. We can print these for $3 a copy. Do the math. $3 times 40,000. We've got to raise $120,000 just to print the Bible. That's not including shipping. And so, you know, I was thinking about Matthew chapter 28. And I was thinking about when our Lord arose from the grave. Aren't you glad he's alive?
Amen.
One of the reasons I like to come to Gethsemane. Gethsemane is alive. Amen. And Jesus said, you go and tell my disciples that I'll meet them there in Galilee. Well, if you go over 3 or 4 verses, you'll find where they met Jesus on the mountain that Jesus had appointed. So evidently, he told them, you go tell my disciples, I'm going to meet them in that mountain there in Galilee. And I believe the reason was this, because he had a message to give them. Because two verses later, he says, he gives us the Great Commission. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And so I believe that was the message that he had for them, to give them the Great Commission. And then, of course, right before he went back to heaven, he gave us Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Be witnesses unto me in Jerusalem. That's here, preacher. That's here. You're doing it. Thank God. You see, if there were no Gethsemane Baptist churches, there would be no Bibles in the Sudan. You see how important you are? By reaching your neighbors, your friends, television, witnessing, door-to-door, tracts, all those things. So Jerusalem is where it begins. And if it doesn't begin at Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the uttermost parts won't matter, because they won't be reached. Because you see, it's the local churches, like Gethsemane Baptist Church. And the reason that 40,000 Sudanians will receive a copy, if they cannot read English, many of them do now. That's the reason we're sending 20,000 in the English language. They'll receive it in the Arabic language. Our Bible in the Arabic language. And so it begins here. And so, you know, thank you so very, very much for the privilege, preacher. and to come and say, hey, you know, will you help us? Joanne and I, we started this now 3 years ago after retiring from pastoring, which we love, for 32 years. And we're doing this now, we hope, until Jesus comes. Amen. To be able to get the gospel to the ends of the earth. The most important message we've got is that Jesus saves. Amen. And that's what the multitudes need to hear. Amen. Thank you, preacher. Amen. God bless you.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Yeah. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. What will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. Oh, I can only imagine.
Amen. It is always an honor to have at Gethsemane Baptist Church a friend. A man who believes the Word of God, who preaches the Word of God. And the years that I've known Bob Lee, he's always been what he believes. He's always lived what he believes. He's always been an example. And I appreciate him, and I appreciate the fact that I can call him a friend, and also that I can call him my brother in Christ. And I appreciate that he's one of those that still stands for the truth of God's word, proclaiming it and living it. And what a blessing we have today to have the honor to be in his presence with he and his wife and to receive the message that he has for us today. I want you to welcome to the platform of Gethsemane Baptist Church, Brother Bob Lee. Let him know today you appreciate him.
Well, that's one of the reasons I like coming here. You're so kind. And your preacher is so kind. And my wife and I are so very, very grateful. And when you leave, my wife will be at the back door with a prayer card. And if you would take that and put it on your refrigerator. And don't put it on your stove, because you probably never turn your stove on. Amen. But if you would put it on your refrigerator, we would appreciate it so very, very much. And again, it's a great privilege to be here. And we do need, a preacher mentioned, we do need a personal support. If you could help us, everything that you gave today will go to the printing ministry and to print Bibles. And but it does cost us greatly to go from city to city and from state to state. And we go all the way from Mississippi. We've already been to Mississippi, Florida. We'll be going to Tennessee, North Carolina, of course, Virginia, South Carolina, the whole eastern seaboard, West Virginia. And you would pray for us and pray that we could raise more support. We'd appreciate that so very, very much. And it is a great joy to be here again. And I'm grateful that I'm saved and on my way to heaven. I don't think there's anything in the world greater. And again, thank you for your kindness. I want to be a blessing and be an encouragement to you today. And to help you along life's way. A lot of trials, isn't there? A lot of heartaches in this old world. And a lot of hurts. But thank God one day we won't have any of them. Amen. Well, we got to reach those. Can you imagine hurting in this life always and then hurting for eternity? What a tragedy. From God's word this morning, John chapter 5, if you would please. From John's gospel chapter 5. I want to talk to you for a few moments about the miracle at the pool. The miracle at the pool. From John chapter 5. Would you stand please in honor of God's word? We'll begin reading in verse 1. We'll read down through a few verses. And we'll have prayer. And then you may be seated. After this, there was a feast of the Jews. And Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. And these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool, troubled the water. Whosoever then first after the troubling of the water stepped in was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity, 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he saith unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man. What a troubling statement. Amen. I have no man. What he was saying, I have no help. I have no help. I have nobody to help me. Nobody. I have no man, he said, when the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me. And Jesus saith unto him, Rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Heavenly Father, I pray you'd help me this morning and help me to be a blessing to your people. Thank you again for their kindness, the kindness of this good man of God. Help me today as I preach. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. After the feast day, Jesus goes up to Jerusalem. And he goes by the sheep market or the sheep gate. You turn back to the book of Nehemiah chapter 3. When Nehemiah was called to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem, there were 10 gates. And what is interesting to me in Nehemiah chapter 3 is this. It is a wonderful picture of the Christian life. And I can't preach on that this morning and from Nehemiah chapter 3. But what is so exciting to me is, aren't you glad the Bible is such a wonderful book? Because the very first gate that Nehemiah and his crew in rebuilding the walls, the very first gate they set up was the sheep gate. And the sheep gate, of course, speaks of sacrifice. It speaks of Calvary. It speaks of the cross. And what is the very first thing you need in life? You need to get saved. You need to go to the cross. And after the cross, and then of course there were nine other gates, and boy, I'll tell you what, and they all reflect the Christian life, because the second gate was the fish gate. And what is the second thing that you do after you get saved? You want to see somebody else saved. Amen? And the Bible is a wonderful book. And but I can't preach on that, but I just want you to know that it was here at the sheep gate, at the sheep market, where the miracle of the pool takes place. And if you'll notice, it says the sheep market, there was a pool which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda. And that word means house of mercy. Aren't you glad for the mercy of Jesus? Aren't you glad that the mercy of Jesus is open to all? Makes no difference. And the Bible said this place had five porches. And of course, the five there, and back in, you go back in the Hebrew, the five porches, that's in reference to the five books of Moses, beginning in the book of Genesis. And it is there that Jesus is going to work a great miracle. Because in these, the Bible says, verse 3, lay a great multitude of impotent folk. Several times the Bible speaks about when Jesus mentions a great multitude. And here in John 5, there's a great multitude of men and women in need. As I look out at this world today and the great multitude of the world, not only the great multitude here at the sheep gate, but the multitude around the world now, which measures, which numbers over 7 billion people, I see a world in need. And what Jesus saw, Jesus said, that was a great multitude of people. When many times in the Bible, when Jesus talks about when there is a great multitude, we'll not turn there, but we could turn to Matthew chapter 4 and verse 25, where there was a great multitude. And the Bible says that Jesus taught the people. He taught the multitude. Now what we need today, we need teaching from this blessed book called the Bible, the Word of God. And when Jesus taught the people, He taught them His Word. Can you imagine not having a Bible? Can you imagine not having a Bible? Not knowing the truth. You see, that's the reason you have all these religious shenanigans over there taking advantage of the people. Why? They don't have the Bible. They don't have the truth. Search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And so when Jesus, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 4, it says that He taught the people. What a sad day we live in. Heard a preacher say the other day, and he's right, preacher. He said that every mainline denomination has accepted the culture of the day and turned aside from the truth of the Bible. And that's true. Every mainline denomination has turned away from the truth of God's Word. They have accepted the culture of the day. But it's not the culture of the day in which we need. We need what Jesus was doing to the people there in Matthew chapter 4. He taught them the Word of God. Amen. And that's what we need. Yes. And why would, and you know, churches turn away from the truth of the Bible and accept and teach the culture and the customs of the day in place of the Word of God. Yes. But that's where we are. So when Jesus saw the multitude, He taught them. He taught them His Word from the Bible. He saw another multitude in Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14 and verse 14. When He saw that multitude, the Bible says, He had compassion. Yes. on the multitude. You know, I can say what whatever I want to say. I can say, man, I love people. I want to help somebody. But if I don't do something, that's just not really true. And when Jesus had compassion on the people, he helped the people. You know, Jude said, some having compassion, making a difference. And that's what happens when we really have people on our hearts. And when we're really concerned about those that are hurting and those that are in trouble, when we have compassion, we reach out and we help them because we have compassion on them. And Jesus had, the Bible says, compassion on the multitudes. In Matthew chapter 15, he saw another great multitude, and he saw them with all kinds of problems. Just like here in John chapter 5, when the Bible says, and these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, blind, halt, lame, withered. Here was a multitude of hurting people who needed help. Now, I believe that we need to. I was with a fellow the other day, and they're building wells and drilling wells, and I think that's great for Africa. As a matter of fact, just went over $1 million this year in raising funds to drill wells. I think that's fantastic. You know, you drill a well for somebody, and you give them some water, and they'll listen to what you have to say. You know? If you give them that physical water, you know what else they'll listen to? Glory to God, they'll listen to the living water. Amen. And that's the purpose of it all. You know, you give them that physical water so that in return, you can give them the living water. But if you just give them the physical water, I mean, listen, that's okay. But what they really need is they need the living water. Amen? And that's where you get it from. You get it out of the Bible. And I thought, boy, that's fantastic. And he said, you know, Bob, he said, we're giving them the physical water. He said, but you know, you're giving them the living water. And that's what we got to do. And here were some folks in need. But I want you to notice something. You know, that can be a great multitude of people. But in that great multitude of people, there's somebody in there that's really hurting. And out of this multitude, can you imagine? The Bible calls it a great multitude. And Jesus sees one man. One man. Just like our Lord looking down from heaven today. And a multitude of folks here this morning, guess what? You're special to him. Because there's a certain person here got a great need in your life and in your heart. And out of the great multitude of people. You know, sometimes I think about, preacher, I think about the 7 billion people in the world today. And I said, you know, 7 billion people, how can the Lord really care about me and 7 billion people? But the truth of the matter, he does. And that was in here, the Bible says, a certain man. Now, this great multitude of people were people that had been wounded. They couldn't help themselves. Not only were they wounded, they were waiting. They were waiting for help. This guy who was lame, been lame, that 38, can you imagine being that 38 years and needing help? And boy, you know, you get so excited, an angel comes and begins to trouble the water. And you begin at some way, somehow, to try to get there. And as you're going along with, but before you can get there, somebody else runs in front of you. Have you always, you know, sometimes in life, you find yourself like that? Thinking sometimes you're always second place and always something happens good happens to somebody else. You know? And you say, now why couldn't that be me? You know, it's always somebody else, isn't it? It's always somebody else that gets a hit. It's always somebody else that seems like it gets a blessing. It's always somebody else that does a little bit better off. But I'm glad the Lord has his eye on us. Amen. And you see, the Lord had an eye on this man. Couldn't help himself. Always at a disadvantage. Thinking like the world had gone past him. Had no hope. And Jesus cared for him. Amen. A certain man was there. You know, when I thought about that in, excuse me, in John chapter 5, and the Bible says, if you look all the way down there in verse 5 with me, it says, and a certain man. I thought about back over in John chapter 4. Verse 7, it says, there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Well, not only was there a certain man that needed help by there at the gate there at Bethesda, the pool at Bethesda, there was a woman who came to the well in John 4, a certain woman who needed help. And then we'll go back to John chapter 3. Go back one chapter back there. What do we find? We find a certain woman. A certain man named Nicodemus who needed help. What I'm trying to get you to see, in a multitude, you can stand out to Jesus because he cares about you. He's concerned about you. He's concerned about your wounds. He's concerned about your waiting. And here's a man who was waiting. Now think about this morning, the multitudes in the Sudan this morning who are waiting. Some of them are waiting. They don't even know they're waiting. But they're waiting for the truth. Now, I've heard stories by missionaries, and they'll lead somebody to the Lord overseas, and the folks will get saved, and they'll ask the question, why didn't you come sooner? My parents died a year ago. Why didn't you come sooner? See, here was a man who was waiting. He was waiting for help. Now, he was waiting for physical help. And of course, not only when in the Bible the Lord healed him physically, healed him spiritually. But here was a man who needed help. And there are millions around this world today who need help from the Bible. They need the Bible. They need the Bible. They need help. Many of them don't even know they're lost. Got religious hucksters and so forth who are preying on the people. And that's what breaks my heart. Is they take advantage of them. But they don't have anything to say, hey, you're wrong. They just listen to them. And they take advantage of them. And these folks were wounded and waiting. And also, no doubt, they were wondering. This man 30, I wonder if help will ever come. I wonder if I'll ever get down. You know, when the angel comes and stirs the water, troubles the water. I wonder if I will ever be able to make it. They were wounded. They were waiting, and they were wondering. Boy, is this the day? Get up in the morning. Is this the day? Well, maybe this is the day I'll be healed. This is the day maybe the angel will come, and I'm going to sit right here next to the spring of water, and the angel comes. I wonder if this is the day. Well, I sort of wonder if this is the day Jesus is going to come. Amen. I'm wondering, is this the day? It's going to be tomorrow. It's going to be the next day. You know, what day is it when Jesus comes? He was wondering. A certain multitude, a great multitude, and a certain man that Jesus cared about his soul. He had been there 38 years, waiting and wondering, and then Jesus came. Not only was there a great multitude and a certain man, there was a certain season. There was a certain season. Now, this is mainly for us today. There was a certain season when Jesus passed by. At the well. In John chapter 4, there was a certain season when Jesus passed by. You go back to John chapter 3 in Nicodemus. There was a certain season when Jesus passed by. You take the two blind men that sat by the wayside begging. There was a certain season when Jesus passed by. And I want to say to you today that this is a certain season right now when the gospel is being preached. And every time you hear the gospel and Jesus passes by, if you let him pass by, that may be the last time he'll pass by your way. You're here this morning, you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Today is a certain season. Today is the day. As the man there by the pool, great multitude, all kinds of folks. But there was a season when Jesus passed by him. Do you know this whole multitude, Jesus said nothing to anybody else but him? All the other folks were there. Great multitude, the Bible says. A great multitude. But Jesus said nothing to anybody else but the man who had lain there for 38 years. Amen. Amen. Sir, wilt thou be made whole? Amen. I remember the day Preacher Jesus passed by. Amen. It'd been 45 years now. Praise God. 45 years when Jesus passed by. And he whispered in my soul, son, wilt thou be made whole?
Yes.
Ah, Jesus, that's what I've been wanting. I just didn't know how to get it. I've been wanting to be made whole, amen? Amen. I've been wanting to be made whole all my life. Yes. I get into bed sometime and wonder about it. Think about it. Talk to myself about it. What if I died today without Jesus Christ? Sir, son, would you be made whole? Yes, Jesus, I want to be made whole. And today, if you're here like the impotent man here, and Jesus is passing by, and he's asking you the question, wilt thou be made whole? And could I say today, this is your season. This is your season. Because you're here. It's your season. Wilt thou be made whole? You know, preacher, I was thinking about if I, in my lifetime, if I could take and have the privilege of giving somebody, just one person. Jesus is concerned about one person. Great multitudes. But he was concerned about this man. And there was a great multitude there. But he turned to that one man and said, sir, wilt thou be made whole? And I was thinking, boy, if I could place within the hands of somebody who had never had a Bible, if I could place within their hands one Bible, how wonderful that would be. Can you imagine being able to place within the hands of hundreds and thousands a copy of God's Word, so that Jesus will say, sir, wilt thou be made whole? And the man would say, well, I don't know how to be made whole. And somebody will say, well, you've got something now called the Bible to show you how to be made whole. Sir, could I just direct you to one verse to make you whole? Could I just direct you to John 3:16? God loves you. God so loved the world. Would you be willing to accept His Son today as your Savior so that you can be made whole? And he would say, oh, yes. I want to be made whole. Will Jesus make me whole? Jesus is the only thing that will make you whole. Nothing else will. Religion won't, popularity won't, people won't, personalities won't. It's just Jesus. Amen. Sir, wilt thou be made whole? And the man was made whole. And today, those of you that are here, somebody never been made whole, today you can be made whole. Because Jesus is the only one that will make you whole. And you know what? You're special to Him today because He's seeking you, just like He sought the one man here in this great multitude here this morning. Jesus seeking you. For what purpose? To make you whole. Save your soul. Give you peace in your heart. So that when you die, you go to heaven. Greatest gift I ever received was Jesus. He made me whole. I'm not everything that I ought to be. But thank God I'm not what I used to be. He's still working on me just the same way He's working on you. But to be able to help somebody with the Bible, thank you for your help today. Some of you gave sacrificially. Some of you are like the widow who cast in her two mites. You don't have a lot. But I want to say thank you. That we'll now be able to take this book. I can't reward you here. But Jesus can. Amen. And when we get over yonder, He'll reward you for what you've done here. I want to say thank you. The miracle at the pool. What a wonderful miracle. We need more of them. But they need the Bible to understand. Would you bow your heads with me just for a moment? Is anybody here today that said, "Preacher, I need to be saved. I want to pray for you today. I'm going to lead you in a sinner's prayer." Same prayer I prayed when I got saved. It works. I'm telling you, it works. If you'll just tell the Lord, do this, there in the quietness of your own heart. "Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I want to be saved. I want to be made whole. And today, the best I know how, I ask you to forgive me of my sins, to come into my heart, to come into my life, and save me right now." While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, is anybody here this morning? I'll not come to you, I'll not embarrass you. Is anybody here this morning say, "Preach, I prayed that prayer this morning. I trusted Jesus as my Savior." Anybody like that this morning? Let me ask you this question. Anybody here this morning knows anybody who needs to be made whole? Do you know somebody needs to be made whole? Let's see your hand. You say, "Preach, I know somebody needs to be made whole." God bless you. Now I'm going to ask you just right where you are. I'm not going to ask you to come forward now, but just right where you are. Would you breathe their name in prayer? And here's the reason. Because folks, getting folks saved is the most important thing in all this world. There's not anything any more important than getting people ready for heaven. Would you just breathe that name in prayer and ask God to save them? And then ask God to use you as an instrument to win them. Heavenly Father, there are many prayers in this building going up, even right now. And Lord, I thank you for the day that you saved my soul. You called me to preach. You've given Joanne and I the wonderful privilege, Lord, of going to great churches like this, meeting so many good folks. I thank you for that. Now, dear Lord, you said, "What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? What shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" Lord, being saved is the most important thing in this world. And Lord, the prayers of these people that are now going up to heaven, Lord, I pray that you might honor them. And I pray, God, that every name that has gone up there to the pearly gates, gone up in your presence. Oh, dear God, I pray for them. And I pray before they leave this world, they'll find Jesus before it's too late. I pray for each one. Thank you again for saving us. Thank you for your mercy and grace. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with us this morning? I'm going to sing a hymn of invitation. If you didn't trust Jesus, I'm going to invite you to come.